Welcome to another Sunday devotional. It is the last Sunday of May. Can you believe it? I know for my kids, they're finishing up school this coming week, and I can't believe that. And then we have summer, which will be nice for all of us, I think. So hopefully you all are doing well and are excited for the summer, and maybe you have some exciting plans coming up. But whatever your plans are, even if you're staying home, I hope you find time to rest and enjoy being with your family. And as we wrap up our school year, I hope that you're able to find lots of things to be thankful for. We made it. We're making it through the year. We're almost done. Okay? All right, friends. Today, before we get into our lesson, I just want to remind you that we are going to, that today's the last day to register for VBS. So if you haven't done it yet, please, please remind your parents to sign you up for VBS. Today's the last day. So friends, in today's lesson, we are going to be talking about eschatology, which we started last week. Now, if you missed last week, don't worry, we're going to review so you won't be confused the whole time about what eschatology is. But before we do that, why don't we pray together and then sing some songs, okay? So let's pray, friends. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for this time, for all of my friends who have been so faithfully watching these devotionals and who are so excited to participate and to learn about who you are. God, we pray as we study your word today that you would open our hearts, open our ears and our minds to understand your word, Lord, and would it always lead us to love you more and to love your people more. We thank you, God, for this time, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, friends, wherever you are, if you have room, why don't we stand together and sing a couple of songs?
To know is, admit to God that you're a sinner.
Thank you, Teacher Praise and Teacher Caroline. I'm so thankful for you. We're all super thankful for you for leading us every week. All right, friends, like I said, we're going to be talking this week about eschatology and specifically the return of Christ. Okay, the return of Christ. Now, just to review, let me ask you this question. What is eschatology? Do you remember what it was from last week? What is eschatology? I'm going to show you what it is, okay? Remember, we said that eschatology is the theology of the end times, or it is what we believe about the final or last things, okay? The final or last things, the last days, it's what the Bible teaches us about those things. That is eschatology. Can you say it with me just one time? Eschatology. And that's a word that maybe you can even talk about with your parents, because maybe some of your parents have heard it, or maybe they haven't, or maybe they know things and would like to share that with you. So this is a great topic to talk about with our families too, okay? So last week we talked about how eschatology, the Bible, gives us a picture of the future, okay? It doesn't tell us exactly what is going to happen, but it gives us a big picture of what the future will be, okay? Now today we're going to talk about what is going to happen when Jesus returns, the return of Christ, right? He's in heaven now, it says in the Bible. He's sitting next to God the Father at his right hand praying for us, but the Bible tells us that he will come back. And so we're going to talk about what that is going to be like according to the Bible. So we're going to look at two passages today. The first one's really short. This one is from 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10, just the first part of it. And it says this, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar." Okay, the day of the Lord will come like a thief. And we're going to talk about what that means, because that sounds kind of strange to us, okay? So we'll talk about that. And our second passage comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 to 17. So you can read that with me here. It says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord." Okay, now this sounds kind of crazy, right? When you think about what this is talking about, the dead rising and meeting the Lord in the air. We're going to talk about all that, because for some of us that might sound weird or even scary, but we're going to talk about what the Bible means by all this and why we don't have to be scared, okay? Now, before we get into it, like I like to do, I want to take us to a new place this week. So I'm going to show you this place that I found, and it's really beautiful. Okay, so take a look, and I want you to guess where it is. Now, if you look at it, I'm hoping obviously that you can tell that it's a castle, right? It's a castle. And we read about castles in storybooks, or we see them in Disney movies. But friends, did you know that there are still many castles actually in the world, and this is one of them? This is a real building. Does anyone want to guess where this castle might be? What do you think? If you guess that it is somewhere in Europe, you are correct. Europe is home to many of the castles that still exist today. Most of these castles are not places where people live all the time. Most of them are places that people can visit, and you can walk through, and it's like you can take tours, but there are a good number of them, and a lot of them are in Europe. Now, where is this one specifically? I'm going to show you. This is called Neuschwanstein Castle, and it is in Germany. Okay, it's in Germany, and it was built by King Ludwig II in the 1800s. He was a king of what was then called Bavaria. Okay. Now, this particular castle, they worked on it for almost 20 years. They started it in the 1860s, and this was actually like the smaller castle. This was kind of like his private retreat where he would go to get away from everything, and where he lived while he was reigning as king was actually bigger. So this is kind of a smallish castle. As you can see, it's big and it's beautiful. They started it while he was alive, but did you know that they actually never finished it it while he was alive. It wasn't finished until after he died, and it wasn't even finished kind of the way he wanted it to be. They just sort of ended the work on it and simplified it and made it so that it would be done. But he did move into the castle at one point, but he only lived there for about 6 months. So after all this work and all of his own money that went to build this castle, he only lived there for a few months. But maybe you're asking, Teacher Kathy, why are you talking about kings and castles? What does that have to do with Jesus coming back? Well, friends, I want you to imagine with me that there is a great and good king. I don't know if Ludwig II was a good king or not, but let's imagine that there is a great and good king whom the people loved so much, and he is a wonderful king, but he's been away for a long time. And finally, he's returning home, and his subjects have been waiting for him to return because they love him so much, and he's such a wonderful king and takes such good care of his people. And so finally, he's riding back into town on his horse or in his carriage and returning towards his castle. And imagine what that is like for the people who have been waiting for him. Can you imagine what that would be like? You could probably imagine that there would be loud trumpets and celebration and joyful noise from his people. And friends, when Jesus came the first time, right? How did he come? How did he come? He came as a baby. He came into very, very poor and humble circumstances. He was born next to the animals, right? But the Bible tells us that when he returns, it will not be as a humble baby, but it will be as a victorious, beloved king. So when he returns, what you pictured in your head about the people cheering and rejoicing and the trumpets playing, that is what the Bible tells us it will be like when Jesus comes again. Now, you might have some questions because this all sounds kind of like a story or something you'd see in a movie. So I'm going to do my best today to answer some of these questions for you. Okay, so your first question might be, is Jesus really coming back? How do we know that Jesus is really coming back? And friends, the way that we know this is the way that we know everything we know about Jesus, which is from the Bible. And the Bible says this in the verses that we read, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven." He's in heaven now, and the Bible tells us he is coming back. It is something that we know for sure. He will return. He will return. We can bank on that, friends, that he is coming back. Okay, so how do we know that this is really true? Is Jesus really coming back? Because the Bible tells us that he is coming back. Okay, now you might have another question. Well, what's it going to be like when he comes back? How is that going to look like to us who are on earth or for whoever is here? Okay, so like I said, friends, when Jesus returns, we talked about imagining that king who's returning from a long journey. The Bible tells us that it will be like that, that he will come as a victorious king. He will come from heaven. And this is what the verse says, "With a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God." So when Jesus came the first time, he came into the world quietly. But it says when Jesus returns, it's not going to be quiet. It's going to be as a mighty, victorious king. Okay? He's going to come back. There will be trumpets and there will be rejoicing. And then some crazy things are going to happen, which we'll talk about in a moment. So when Jesus comes back, no one's going to be able to ignore it. It's not going to be something that happens quietly. There won't be any questions. We will know when Jesus returns, okay? So that's what it's going to be like, a mighty king returning, okay, to claim his victory. Okay, here's another question that maybe some of you are asking, okay? And I used to ask this myself when I was a kid and we would talk about Jesus returning. When is this going to happen? When will he come? Well, this is what the Bible tells us. It says, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief." Now, what does that mean, friends? Well, you've probably seen in movies that when people come to steal something, right, they don't come and say, hey, everyone, like, this is when I'm going to do it. I'm going to be robbing your house or I'm going to be robbing the bank this Thursday at 9 a.m., okay? So just to let you know that that's when it's going to happen. It's not going to happen like that, right? When a thief comes to take something, they do it when nobody knows and nobody's expecting it, right? And that's what the Bible says about when Jesus will return. It's going to happen at a time that no one knows and no one expects it. Now, I'm going to tell you this, friends. All throughout history, ever since Jesus was taken up, people have been trying to guess when he's going to come back. I don't know why people do this when the Bible tells us that you can't know, but people have been trying to guess. So people use math sometimes, or they try and figure out like clues from the Bible to guess when Jesus is going to return. I think for some people, it makes us feel better thinking that we can predict the future, thinking that we are in control and that we are a little bit like God. But God says no one knows. When I was a kid, there was, and this has happened many times, even, you know, while I've been alive, but there's always people trying to guess. But I remember specifically when I was a kid, maybe in about like fourth or fifth grade, maybe a little older, fifth or sixth grade, there was this booklet that came out and it predicted a specific month and a day and a year when Jesus would come back. And they used some kind of math to figure things out and things from the Bible. And they figured out, they thought, the day and the month and the year when Jesus would return. And a lot of people believed it because people wanted to know. So people were kind of preparing themselves and trying to make sure that they told other people about Jesus before he came. And then some people even like sold their things to get ready for Jesus coming. But friends, do you know what happened? That day came and it went, and Jesus didn't come that day, and now it's like 30 years later. Why? Because the Bible tells us that nobody knows. Only God himself knows when he is going to come. So even though we might want to know, we might want to know so much, when is Jesus coming? Because it will help us to live each day feeling like, oh, I know what's going to happen. But God doesn't tell us that. And he says, just trust me and know that it will happen. It will happen. But it's not for us to know the day or the time. Okay? No one knows. Now, so we've talked about two things. The first is that Jesus will come as a victorious king, and the second is that we don't know when that's going to happen. So, to illustrate these two things, I have a little game for us to play, okay? Now, it's an easy game. All you have to do is take a look at this picture that I'm going to show you, and you have to count the tigers, okay? Just count the tigers that you see, okay? All right, so I'm going to let you look at this picture for a few seconds. Okay, I'm going to get out of the way. And then I'm going to let you look at this picture for a few seconds. I might keep talking a little bit just so that, you know, it's not silent. But I want you to look at the picture and see how many tigers you can count. Okay, see how many you can find. I will give you a hint. It's more than what you see when you first look at the picture. Okay, so there might be some hidden ones in there. So see how many you can find, okay? When I looked at it the first time, I couldn't find them all. It's more than what you think. All right, I am going to go ahead and talk about it now. I'm going to show you some of the answers. But if you want more time, you could pause it right here. And then you can take more time to count them. And then you can unpause it when you're ready, okay? All right, so let's look at this picture again with all the tigers in it, okay? So here I'm going to show you the ones that probably all of you found, right? These are the four tigers that are right in the front of the picture, okay? Now these tigers remind me of the way that Jesus is going to return, the way he will return, okay? He will return strong and victorious and bold, and you will see it. Just like you see these tigers right in front of you, and they look brave and strong, like they know that they are powerful. That reminds me of the way that Jesus will return as a victorious king. But, friends, You probably found some of them. There are also hidden ones, hidden tigers in this picture. Okay? Did you find a few of them? How many of them did you find? How many tigers did you find total? Okay, I'm going to show you the answer. Friends, in this picture, there are 16 tigers. Okay, there are the four that we see easily, and then there are 12 other tigers hiding in this picture. Can you see them? Look, I've circled them all here for you. Some of them are really hard to find. I couldn't find them all on my own, okay? Now, friends, those first four tigers, the ones that are right up front, remind me of the way that Jesus will return. Strong, bold, and mighty. But these 12 hidden tigers remind me that of the when that Jesus will return, that we don't know, that it's kind of hidden from us because God has not chosen to tell us that, okay? They remind me that no one knows everything. We don't know the day or the time or the year. The Bible only tells us how he will come and that he will come, okay? So I hope you enjoyed that little game. I thought this picture was really cool. I could not find them all. Okay, so we've talked about the fact that Jesus is coming. We talked about what it will be like and when he will come, which we don't know. Okay, and then maybe the next question that you have is, Teacher Kathy, well, when he comes, what is going to happen? What does it mean that he's coming back? Okay, so let's look at these verses again. This is from the 1 Thessalonians passage. It says, "And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." Okay, so what this tells us, friends, is that when Jesus comes again, when the trumpets sound and he returns, those people who have died, okay, who have died in the past, and all the Christians from all the previous years, from thousands of years, that their bodies will rise. Now, friends, when people die, when we die, we know that our souls go to be with Jesus, okay? And our souls are in heaven, and we are rejoicing and worshiping there. But when Jesus returns, the bodies will rise, but they won't be like the old bodies that we had, okay? The Bible tells us that the bodies that we have will be perfect and beautiful. And the word that the Bible uses is glorified. We will have a glorified body. So friends, now we die for many reasons, sometimes because we're so old or because people are sick or something happened to them. But the Bible tells us that when Jesus comes and the bodies rise, they will be beautiful and perfect, that there will be no more sickness, no more pain, no more suffering, and we can all look forward to that. And then it says that's what's going to happen to those who have already passed away. But for those who are still living when Jesus comes, that our bodies will go up and rise and meet him in the air, and we will receive new bodies as well. Bodies that are perfect, that are no longer in pain or sick or broken, okay? We will receive new bodies as well, which is so wonderful. That's what's going to happen, okay? We will all rise together and meet Jesus in the air. So this is a very interesting picture of what's going to happen, and it's supposed to be something beautiful and wonderful. Perfect now, glorified, wonderful bodies meeting our King in the air. Okay, so like we said, the Bible doesn't tell us when all that's going to happen, but it tells us that it will happen and that we should be ready. So maybe your next question is, well, how can I be ready? What does that mean to be ready for Jesus to come? Does that mean that I'm always like this? Like, okay, is he coming now? Is he coming today? Is he coming tomorrow? No, friends, that is not what it means. Let's look again at a different passage. This one comes from 1 John 2:28. It says this, "And now, little children..." Okay, "abide in him so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink from him in shame at his coming." Okay, abide in him so that when he does come, we can meet him with joy. What does it mean to abide in him, friends? When the Bible tells us to be ready for Jesus to come, it means this: live out your faith in him. Being ready means we put our full faith in Jesus and we live as believers. That's all it means, friends. It doesn't mean we have to sell all our things or that we have to do something crazy. It means live as faithful followers of Jesus. Put your trust in him. Believe in him. Believe that what the Bible says is true. Believe that when the Bible says that we are sinful, that Jesus had to come to live a perfect life, to die for us, to pay the penalty for our sins, and had to rise again, and that he now is in heaven praying for us and preparing a place for us. Believe that those things are true. And then live your life knowing that that is true. That's what it means, friends. To be ready, we just have to believe, okay? So maybe some of you are hearing all this and you're thinking, well, this all sounds very interesting. Is it something that I should be scared of? You know, like trumpets and Jesus coming and then going to meet him in the air. And the answer, friends, is no. This is not something that should be scary at all. It's actually something wonderful and beautiful. Why? Because what happens when this all takes place? When Jesus comes and the trumpets sound and then we come and we meet him in the air, what happens after that? It tells us in the passage, and so we will always be with the Lord. Once this happens, friends, we will always be with him in heaven, near him, being able to see him. And that, friends, is not something to be scared of, right? When we think about Jesus coming again, we should feel the opposite of scared. This is not scary, friends. He's going to return. And when he does, he's going to make all the old things new and all the broken things whole. And everything that is right now that is broken because of sin and pain and all of those things will not be there anymore. Instead, he will make us perfect and we will live with him in heaven. So knowing, friends, that he's going to come again in victory as our king and in victory over all of the sin in the world and in victory over death, friends, that's not something to be scared of. Actually, it's something that should give us great hope and joy and comfort. Because when we look at the world around us, things are not always great, right? There are people who are sad and hungry and who need things and so many different broken things in the world. But friends, our hope is knowing that it's not always going to be this way. And that is such good news for us, friends. So why don't we close our time thinking about that wonderful day, and then let's pray the Lord's Prayer together, okay? You can close your eyes and pray with me, or you can read it up here if you don't know it, okay? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thanks, friends, for joining me. Thanks for learning about eschatology, which is kind of a hard topic, but thank you for sticking with me and for playing my tiger game. So I hope you have a wonderful week. Please remember to sign up for VBS if you haven't already. And if your parents have any questions, you can have them contact me and I will be happy to answer those questions. Okay? All right. Thanks, friends. I hope you have a wonderful week and an excellent end to your school year if you're finishing soon. And I will see you next time. Okay? Bye.